You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. And this course, or garden show, is all about how to maintain your garden, what to grow in your garden, how to deal with pests, how to fertilize, how to prune. And that's really for all of the Western United States to a large extent, but mostly we talk about Southern California. We broadcast from the campus here at Cal State University, Dominguez Hills in Carson. And today is a beautiful day out, wonderful January 18th, 2015. And this is a live broadcast, and you can call in with your questions about your garden at 1-800-339-1193. My name, as I told you, is Gerald Turney. I am a plant pathologist and a certified arborist and an agricultural pest control advisor in the state of California. And I've worked at botanical gardens for a while, but the last 15 years, I have worked for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner's Office, where I supervise a plant diagnostic laboratory where we diagnose plant diseases, identify weeds, identify nematodes, and we also have an entomologist, Dr. R. Kalian, who identifies insects, snails, other mollusks, arachnids, so mites, ticks, and well, not so much the ticks, but mites and spiders. So if you have questions about what our department does, I'd be happy to talk about the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner Weights and Measures Department. We do a lot of things in Los Angeles County. Beyond agriculture, because we are a combined department with weights and measures. If you're interested in what our department does, call in. We'll talk about it. If you have any questions about your garden, and we're going to talk about in a minute what you should be doing in your garden. And today's lecture, though, will be on camellias and how to take care of them and all the different flower forms and where the history of camellias, because it's a fascinating history. So we'll talk about that in a minute, but we like to start our program with upcoming events. If you are a student enrolled in this course, you do need to attend an outside event and write a 1 to 2 page essay about what you learned about plants at that event. So the types of events that you can attend are plant society meetings, garden club meetings, flower shows, lectures on plant materials at the various botanical gardens. We have a lot of wonderful botanical gardens in Southern California. We've got Descanso Gardens in La Cañada, the Huntington Botanical Gardens in San Marino, the Los Angeles County Arboretum in Arcadia. And just to digress, I curated the camellia collection at the Huntington for 3 years after I finished grad school. I went over to the Arboretum for 2 years, and then in 2000, I transferred to the Ag Commissioner's Office. But so you've got those three, plus you've got Rancho Santa Ana in La Verne for native plants particularly. I mean, that's their specialty is native California species. And then if you go down to the Fullerton Arboretum, the San Diego Botanical Garden, we just have a lot of resources for plant information, especially the Arboretum where they have plant information specialists to help you. And you can always call into the show. We're going to be on the air for the next roughly 15 weeks. We do take a break at Easter, but other than that, we'll be on every Sunday from 12 to 2. And as I said, we're live. So give me a call if you have a question about your garden, if you've had a plant die, if you had a problem with your vegetable garden last summer, if you're interested in winter vegetables, you know, all the different things you can grow during the winter. We grow different things in the winter than we grow in the summer, obviously. So give me a call. our textbook, if you're a student, is actually the Sunset Western Garden book. This is the first book that any gardener in the Western United States should purchase if they're going to buy a book on gardening. It's an encyclopedia of plants, but that's not all. It has at the beginning of the book a section on plant uses, and just to maybe go to the overhead briefly, and then we'll go on to upcoming events just to show you this book if you're not familiar with it. It tells you about all the zones, all the they have different zones here in California. Let me just, Western Idaho, Eastern Oregon, Idaho, that's these zones, but zone 2A and all the way. Now those are mostly the cold zones. Here are the ones you find in Southern California, zone 18, 19, 17, 16, up to 24. You can read about all those zones. You can see what zone you're in. That will dictate what kind of plants you can grow that will do well. And then plant selection guide. So perennials with showy flowers, plants to attract hummingbirds, plants for rock gardens, annuals for season color, landscape plants with showy flowers. And then the last section is dear to my heart, of course, is here's tropical plants, damp soil and ponds, swimming pools. You can see that, you know, give you a lot of suggestions for plants to grow in your garden. I'm trying to get to the last section, which is plants that are resistant to oak root rot. And we'll talk more about, here's plants that are resistant to the oak root rot fungus. This is a major pathogen in Southern California, a mushroom forming pathogen that kills trees and shrubs. It's in my yard in the San Gabriel Valley, where it is, you know, there's a lot of our malaria or oak root rot fungus in the San Gabriel Valley. Also in the Beverly Hills, West LA area, I see it a lot there. So this is the Sunset Western Garden book. If you're a student, there will be assigned reading on each group. the syllabus isn't up yet. It will be up this week. And so there is a section in here on camellias, and that would be what you should pre-read before the lecture. So you have a little background, and you know a little bit about what we're going to talk about. What are we going to talk about over the next 14 classes? We're going to talk about insects, integrated pest management. We'll talk about oaks. We'll talk about killer plant diseases that have wiped out trees, and we have some serious diseases in Southern California killing a lot of common trees that are grown here now. Not natives, well, even some natives too, but a lot of different trees, including natives. Then we'll talk about those kind of things. We'll probably talk about roses. We'll talk about summer vegetable gardening. We're going to talk about gardening, and any subject you want to talk about, call me up, call in the show. And we'll talk about that so we can answer your questions. I do have a lot of experience gardening. I'm an avid vegetable gardener, as well as I grow a lot of stuff. My undergraduate degree at Cal Poly is in botany, and my graduate degree from UC Riverside is in plant pathology, where I got my doctorate working on citrus root rot, a fascinating subject. So give us a call, 1-800-339-1193. And we'll talk about your garden and how you can make it a beautiful garden or a wonderful vegetable garden. Now, let's take a look at some upcoming events, and then we'll move on to what you should be doing in your garden right now. So what do we have on our upcoming event calendar? Let's take a look at that. We have the Newport Harbor Orchid Society in Costa Mesa, Community Center, 1845 Park Avenue. This is January 20th from 7 to 10. And I'm not sure if this is a flower show or their regular meeting, but give them a call at 714-327-7525. And if you're interested in orchids, and we will talk about orchids during the class, we'll talk all about the different kinds of orchids and how to grow them and which ones are easy to grow in Southern California. So go on down to this meeting or flower show and learn more about orchids. They are a wonderful group of plants. And there's usually room in most people's gardens for at least one or two orchids. There are some you can grow outdoors. In addition to that, we have the Orange County Orchid Society is also meeting at the Yorba Linda Public Library, January 21st. This is probably their monthly meeting. Go on down. This is a great way to meet people and get out of your house and stop watching TV all the time. You know, I may digress here a little bit. You know, back before TV was so intensely popular, or before it existed, actually, people actually interacted with their neighbors and knew them. We can come back to me now. We don't need that up anymore. So, oh, one more. The Pacific Rose Society annual auction. It will be at the LA County Arboretum January 31st. This is a great opportunity to get some probably bare root roses. They may be in pots or they may be bare root. And get some new varieties or get some old varieties that you want to grow. If there's an old cultivated variety, then you probably will pick it up there or get some of the new stuff. And there's roses. Boy, you can talk about roses until you turn blue in the face. So that's our last upcoming event. But let me just comment that prior to the development of television, people, you know, of course, could listen to the radio when after that was invented. But they really got out of their houses and interacted with their neighbors. And they would go to meetings, neighborhood meetings, plant society meetings, gardening society meetings, and you would actually get to know people. And so you should do that. We all should do that. Get out of our houses, get to know our neighbors, get to know people in the community. And one of the ways you can do that is by joining or attending various meetings of all the different plant societies and plant groups. Los Angeles Horticultural Society, and they talk about everything. Or you could go to the Rose Society meeting or the Cactus and Succulent Society meetings. A lot of these meetings are held at the Arboretum of Los Angeles County in Arcadia. But so there's a Fern Society, there's a Camellia Society, and the Camellia Society puts on flower shows, and you don't have to join their society to go to the flower shows. They hold them at Descanso Gardens. They hold them at the Huntington Gardens. And they hold them at various locations throughout Southern California. And those are ongoing. There's usually one every Sunday. So go on the calendar for the Huntington, go on the calendar for Descanso, and see when their next Camellia flower show is. And go on down and take a look, because it will blow your socks off. There'll be 1,000 blooms out displayed on the tables. There'll be everything from little miniatures to big, huge ones. Every color, every shape, every form. You'll be able to look at all these different camellias. And of course, if you have only space for one or two in your garden, you'll have a real hard time picking which one you want to grow because they're all so beautiful. So that's just my digressing and to tell you to get out of the house and enjoy our Southern California weather. Enjoy the gardens we have here in Southern California. And get to know your neighbors and your community. So what should you be doing in your garden right now? Well, it's winter. It's not so hot, cold, but it's winter. So you need to prune. It's always best to prune dormant plant materials, dormant trees, roses, stone fruits during the winter months, especially roses and stone fruits. You need to prune your stone fruits, peaches, nectarines, plums, cherry, did I say peach? You know, those are stone fruits. They need to be pruned every winter, and you prune them pretty hard. You take out about 2/3 of the wood. And why do you do that? Because the first response to pruning is rapid new growth. New growth on stone fruits will flower better and produce more fruit. If you don't prune, your yield will go down year after year after year, and then you'll end up with a very crowded tree with too much wood and too many branches, and you want to really prune it correctly. And we'll talk more about how to prune trees. We talked about it, of course, last semester, but we'll talk about it some more. And then the other thing is to prune your roses. The real window for pruning both groups, stone fruits and roses, is about December 15th to about February 15th. So you still have about 4 weeks to get out and get your roses pruned back, especially the large shrub roses. Maybe not climbing roses so much, because you want to let climbing roses climb all over the place. But the hybrid teas, the floribundas, flor grandes, you know, or grandiflora, I should say, you know, the shrub roses, you prune them down. You usually prune them down to about 3 or 4 canes, about shin high to knee high, and open up the center, that kind of thing. You can find a lot of information about pruning roses, but this is the time of year to do it. Why do you do it? Well, it controls the size of the shrub. It forces them into dormancy because we don't get quite cold enough for roses to go completely dormant. You want to make sure after you prune it that you pick off all the leaves. There's no leaves left on it. And that forces them into dormancy. And then they're going to grow a lot of new growth. And then in the spring, usually about mid-March to sometime in April, they will explode with blooms, and you'll get this tremendous flowering of the roses. If we get some good cold weather, that will help, because that will really push them into dormancy. Then when they come out of dormancy, they pop, bang, and you get all these flowers, and they're spectacular. This time of year is also really excellent for planting bare root roses and bare root fruit trees, or really planting any shrubs or trees. It's always best to plant in the fall and into the winter. You kind of miss that fall window if you haven't planted, but it's not too late, especially for the bare roots. If you want to get bare root roses or bare root stone fruits, peaches, and all the things I mentioned before, then this is the best time of year to do that. Prepare your site before you go buy the plants, so you don't buy the plants and sit them in the corner and then wait several weeks to plant them, and then they're going to suffer. And you might even lose them if they're bare root. But this is when you can find the bare roots in nurseries. So if you go to Home Depot or Lowe's or Armstrong or Osh or your local nursery, there's many, many nurseries out there. You'll find that this is the time of the year they have the bare roots in stock. And they're much cheaper bare root than grown in a pot. So this is the best time of the year to purchase these things and save a little money and get them in during the winter months. So that's that. Now, the other thing is to start planning your summer vegetables. Where you're gonna site your summer vegetable garden? Summer vegetables, and really most vegetables, really need a lot of sun. 12 hours or more would be excellent. 10 hours is okay. 8 is getting a little skinny. But anything less than 8, and you're really not gonna get that good a yield. You might be able to get tomatoes on a plant that only gets 6 hours of sun, but you're not gonna get a lot of tomatoes. And if you get down to 4, you probably won't get any tomatoes. So the things to do is to prepare your soil. What I'm doing right now is putting down cardboard and covering it with mulch or compost or wood chip or anything to suppress weeds. With all this, we've gotten a little bit of rain. We're looking like we might have a normal rainfall year, which is great because we desperately need it. Excuse me. And so with all that rain, if you just have your old plot where you had your summer vegetables last year and you didn't plant any winter vegetables, well, it's just bare dirt and it's just going to get covered with weeds. All the weeds that produce their seeds and they float in and land in your backyard, and it rains and they start growing. So you're going to start seeing annual grasses coming up, Chenopodium, a common weed, cheeseweed, pigweed. There's all these weeds that come up all over the place. And how can you best prevent them, or at least make it easier to plant in March, which is really March 15th is your kind of your planting date for most summer vegetables. Although some people go ahead and put their tomatoes in as early as right now or February, a little early. But you can't do that for certain plants, but you can get away with that with tomatoes. So what I do is I put down cardboard and I cover that with about 4 inches of compost. That suppresses all the weeds. You won't get any. And then as soon as, if you get that down now, and if we get a little rain and the cardboard rots away and the mulch, starts to decompose a little more, then you just turn it into the soil and plant in March. So you definitely want to, in preparation for a summer vegetable garden, add a lot of organic matter to your soil. You may want to build raised beds. Start planning on where you're going to put your raised beds. Raised beds are excellent for any plant, really, but really excellent for summer vegetables or your winter vegetables. There's also something you can do if you've had a problem in certain areas. Now, if you had a soil-borne problem, and there's a bunch of soil-borne problems, you can have Phytophthora root rot, you can have other forms of root rot, you can have nematodes, and of course you can have these really problem weeds. One of the things you can do to organically fumigate your soil, and you do that in the winter, is to either grow cabbage or some type of coal crop. So it could be mustard, it could be rape, which is rapeseed is made to make used to make canola oil. It's actually, I think, a brassica. But cabbage works really, really well, and you grow it up, you chop it all up and turn it into the soil green, tarp that and let it rot in the soil. And as it rots, it gives off chemicals that will kill all the nematodes, kill all the soil-borne diseases. And it really, really is excellent for the soil. So that's an organic way to fumigate your soil. If you don't have cabbage, and if you have a source of old rotten cabbage, that's perfect. And I've had people who've done that. They go to a supermarket and they'll ask, you got any old cabbage you want to throw away? And you could also use broccoli, you could use cauliflower, you could use Brussels sprouts, any old rotted plants from the Brassicaceae, the cold crops. So you turn that into the soil, maybe to 4 inches deep, 6 inches deep at the, would be fine too. And then cover that with a tarp, seal the edges of the tarp into the soil, let it stay that way for about 3 weeks, pull the tarp, turn the soil, and you'll have really knocked back any like root knot nematode or any other nematodes that are plant pathogenic. But root knot's probably the most common one that people bring me from their backyard gardens. The other thing is, not too late to plant some winter materials. A lot of these winter plants or vegetables that we grow are fairly fast, especially on warm days like today. We're going to be in the 70s, close to 80 in the inland valleys. So you can sprinkle out lettuce seed. You could still plant peas, snap peas or regular peas, spinach, cilantro. And so there's a lot of things. It may be getting a little late to grow some of the head lettuce, because by the time it starts to head up, we're going to be into March, and it's going to bolt, and it's going to flower. And then, of course, once lettuce flowers, it gets bitter. So the leaf lettuce, romaine, there's all sorts of different leaf lettuces you can grow, so those are really nice to grow. Spinach is a winter crop as well. And cilantro is also a winter crop. In the summer, it flowers it bolts and flowers, and then you get the mature leaves instead of the juvenile leaves, and it doesn't taste so good. But you can let it flower and take the seeds and grind them up, and that is coriander. So cilantro is both used for the juvenile foliage as a herb, and the seeds are used as a seasoning too, as coriander. If you want to grow some wildflowers, it's not too late to turn some soil, rake it out flat, and broadcast a wildflower seed, particularly California poppy. You will get a show like you will not believe if you broadcast California poppy seed. They are so pretty. Now, they bloom in the spring, and then maybe for 4 weeks to 6 weeks, and then it's going to be done. But it's really, really pretty. And you can also get wildflower mixes. Well, you'll get a variety of flowers. And actually, one of the really fun things that I did in my garden years ago was to broadcast some wildflower mixes and see a lot of flowers come up that I wasn't familiar with, and they're not listed on the seed packet. And so it took me a while to figure out what they were, things like Clarkia and a few others. But that's things you can be doing in your garden right now. So, let's talk about camellias. Oh no, let's not talk about camellias. Let's talk about a couple other things before we talk about camellias. I said you could get stone fruits and plant them this time of year, and you can get them bare root. Well, what stone fruit do you want to get? Which one are you going to pick? Let's go to the overhead, and I'm going to show you this. This is the edible fruit descriptive guide from Ellie Cook. Ellie Cook is probably the largest grower of fruit trees in the western United States, and probably maybe all of North America. I don't know about the East Coast so much. But this is their edible fruit descriptive guide. And it talks about zones. But more importantly, well, I went a little too far. Let me just flip it over and show you what's from it. This is apples. It lists the variety. Here's Anna. I know you can't read that, but I'll just tell you. It gives you a description of the fruit. Large, light greenish-yellow skin with red blush. But more importantly for Southern California, it tells you how many hours you need in order for the plant of chill you need for the plant to bloom. This is called vernalization, 200 to 300 hours. That is low chill, and you can grow that in Southern California almost anywhere, and it will flower and give you fruit. Vernalization is a requirement that a lot of fruit trees have in order to go dormant, and it's hours below 45 degrees during the winter. And so 200 to 300 is low. You can pretty much get away with 500 or less in Southern California, but if you try and grow an apple that needs 900 hours, you're not going to get any flowers because it's not going to go dormant and it just won't bloom in the spring. So they have everything in here, plums, peaches, nectarines, stone fruits, all the stone fruits, apples, pears, really everything. They have brambles. This is all apples, apricots, plumcot, peachcot, dwarf apricots, cherries, a bunch of different kinds of cherries. There are low-chilled cherries. But you can also eliminate the ones you know you can't grow. Royal Anne, 900 hours. Well, you might be able to grow that up at Big Bear, but not down here in the valley. Figs, they have all these different figs that they grow. So this is a great little book from Ellie Cook, the Edible Fruit Descriptive Guide. If you go to their website, the Ellie Cook website, they have point of sale flyers. You can read those. It'll describe the fruit and tell you how many hours of chill they require, so you know if it's appropriate for where you live. Now, if you're down at the beach, you might not want to get anything over that needs more than 300 hours. If you're in the valleys, about 500 hours. If you're up in Altadena, you could probably do, or Sierra Madre, or La Cañada, where you get a little colder, you might get away with 600, even 700 hours. So you got to pick your fruit trees, especially those that require chill, based on where you live and how well they'll do in your garden. So that's the edible fruit guide I wanted to share with you. The other thing I wanted to share with you is this. Let's go to the overhead again. Because, and I've talked about this a lot, is we obviously have a drought and a water shortage. And so getting rid of the aspects of your garden that guzzle water, particularly your lawn. Lawns use a tremendous amount of water to keep them alive in Southern California. And for the most part, they're just green blobs that you walk past in the morning on the way to work and then in the evening when you walk back into your house, and you don't utilize that space. It'd be much nicer to have shrubs and ground covers that don't need to be mowed, that don't need to be watered two or three times a week. You might water them once a month in the spring and the fall, and every 2 weeks in the summer, depending on the plant materials you pick. And this, what I have here, is the drought-tolerant garden. This is from the Los Angeles County Handbook. And you can find this just by putting into Google or any search engine, the Drought Tolerant Garden. It's really an excellent handbook. And it gives you a lot of plant materials that you can use. Now this got flipped. Maybe the whole thing got flipped. This part flipped. Here we go. So it shows you site plans. It tells you all about plant materials, sidewalks. But what's really nice is the list of plants in here, because you can go through and there's quite a few plants in this handbook. Now, I printed this out from the internet, the Drought Tolerant Garden, Los Angeles County Handbook. And you can just, you don't have to print it, just bookmark it in your browser and go back and refer to it. You don't have to print it. You don't have to waste your ink or paper. So there's a lot of resources for converting your garden from a water guzzler to a water sipper. And the number one way to do that is to get rid of your lawn. And I did get rid of my back lawn. I still have a very small front lawn, but that one's, its days are numbered too. So now, let's talk about a couple things. First, I do want to show you our first photograph. Let's bring our first photograph up and talk about this tree before we talk about camellias. Let's see if we've got this. Bring this up full screen. If we can have that full screen. This is blooming all over town right now. This is Magnolia solanagiana. It is known as the saucer magnolia or oriental magnolia. And they are just starting to bloom. And you can't miss them. They're quite common throughout Southern California. They're deciduous. It is a deciduous magnolia. There's a lot of different kinds of magnolias. And let's take a look at our next picture, which is a close-up of the blooms themselves. And you can see how pretty they are. They come in a wide variety of colors, all the way from this kind of pinkish purple to a dark purple. It can be white. The outsides of the petals have the color, and the insides are white, regardless of the variety. There are hundreds of named varieties of Magnolia slanagiana. It's actually a hybrid between two other magnolias, and I don't recall those two species offhand. But anyway, this is Magnolia slanagiana, the oriental tulip tree, or just the tulip tree. And they're starting to bloom all over town, and if you look around, you'll see them. They are a wonderful flowering tree for Southern California, do really well. Although in the late summer, as it gets, the heat of August and September, by October, the foliage will not look so great. They do suffer in the summer heat, but when they bloom, they're absolutely spectacular. But now let's talk about camellias, because that's what we're here to talk about. So let's come back to me. And, oh, I forgot one other thing. I have a mystery plant. This is a mystery plant. If we go to the overhead, you take a look at this. If you know what this plant is, give us a call and tell us what you think this mystery plant is. And here they are. These are actually all individual little plants in a 4-inch pot. These over here have died because these are a little sensitive to getting watered. If you water them at the wrong time, they just turn to mush. This is, of course, a succulent. And let me just keep spinning it. And it's actually referred to as a window plant because these markings are actually allowing sunlight into the leaf to illuminate the leaf and so that it can do photosynthesis. I don't want to give it away, but if you recognize this plant or the genus, there's a common name for them and, of course, the genus. And if you know this plant, give us a call. This is our mystery plant today. And hopefully I won't forget to tell you what it is by the end of the show. So there you go. And our number is 800-339-1193. So let's talk about camellias. Camellias are, of course, they are native to China and Japan and Southeast Asia. They are a little tender. There are some camellias that will grow where it snows, but not many. And they don't normally, or are not normally grown where you get hard freezes, because that will kill them. They are named after George Joseph Camel by Carlos Linnaeus. Linnaeus is the father of plant taxonomy. And Joseph Camel probably never saw a camellia because he was a botanist who worked in the Philippines and they're not native to the Philippines, so he probably never saw one. As I said, they're native to Southeast Asia, Japan, Korea, and China. And the tea plant that we make green and black tea from, Camellia sinensis, is one of the species within the genus. There are about 200 species in the genus Camellia. Tea was used as early as 500 BC. So tea has been used a long time in China. Then it actually was imported into Japan because Camellia sinensis is not native to Japan, it's native to China. And it was very valuable. And in fact, when European explorers got to Japan and brought tea back to Europe, it was worth a lot of money. And in England, they would keep it in silver tea boxes, and it would cost as much as 50 pounds for an ounce. And this is, 200 years ago. So a long time ago, it was extremely expensive. Today we think of tea as being inexpensive, really cheap. But a long time ago it was very expensive because it had to be brought back on a boat from Asia. And those boats, it took them a year or two to go there and come back. And when they come back with their boat loaded with silks and spices, it would actually make the captain a wealthy man if he could actually complete that voyage. Tea was pressed into blocks and used as a currency throughout China. And the blocks would be about the size of a piece of paper, about this big. And you could break off a piece and use and pay someone with that. The farther away from where the tea is grown and pressed, the more valuable it became. Tea was brought to England in the 16th and 17th centuries. The first drawing of camellia that was appeared in Europe was in 1702 by James Petiver. And more drawings of camellias were in Europe in A Natural History of Birds, published by George Edwards in England in 1745. This book contained a plate with a camellia, which he called a China rose. And of course, because everyone wanted the tea, and tea was very valuable, European explorers wanted to bring the tea plants back to England. And the Chinese didn't want to give them to them. So they gave them other camellias. And as I said, there's about 200 species. Camellia sinensis is used to make tea. We grow, for the most part, three different species as ornamentals in Southern California: Camellia japonica, Camellia sasanqua, and Camellia reticulata. Now, japonica is by far the most common. Sasanqua is pretty common too, and reticulata you see a little bit, but not a whole lot. There are other species too that are available in the trade, and you can get them, although you got to go to specialty nurseries to get them. But you don't see them very often, and they're not common at all. So when these explorers wanted to bring tea back to Europe, they were given Camellia japonica, and they brought it back to Europe. It wasn't, Camellia japonica doesn't make a good tea, but it has really pretty flowers that bloom in the winter. Right now, right now is the peak of bloom for Camellia japonica, and that was a sensation in Europe because for the most part they had very few things that would bloom in January and February. That's the heart of winter, and most plants are dormant and there's no flowers. So they have these camellias that are blooming in January, and they called them China roses. And they were, of course, available out of their nurseries. Once they were brought back and propagated, people made them available, but people kept them in greenhouses in the winter to prevent them from freezing. Of course, in some parts of Europe, it's quite easy to grow them, especially Southern Europe, Portugal and Spain and Italy and Greece. But in the northern parts of Europe, where it gets hard freezes, you'd have to protect them. But there are some that will survive outdoors in snow, just not very many. Now, the first Camellia reticulata was brought to England in 1820 from Canton, China, by Sea Captain Richard Rawes. And of course, there is a reticulata named after him now. It's a beautiful, beautiful flower. Tea growing in the United States was attempted in both Savannah and Charleston, but failed. There is still, I think, one tea plantation off the coast of the southeast seaboard. Camellia japonica plants were imported from England into the United States in 1797 and 1798. The camellia pioneer of the West was James Warren of Sacramento, who had plants shipped to Sacramento in 1852. So camellias have been around in California, United States, for a long time. And Sacramento is considered a camellia city, and the capital in Sacramento, the park around the capital, has many large camellias. And so they're gorgeous, and they're blooming this time of year. They became very popular in 1920, or by 1920, and when Sacramento was named the Camellia City. And in 1945, the American Camellia Society was formed. There are six flower forms. And let's take a look at some flowers. And of course, in China, with its thousands of years of history, camellias were selected, and the ones in the gardens aren't the wild forms. So when explorers would be in China and go into gardens and see camellias, that's not the wild form of the camellia. Those are selected varieties that have been selected over thousands of years. So let's take a look what a wild camellia would look like. This is our third picture. Let's bring this one up. Here we go. Bring that up full screen. And this is a single flower. There are six flower forms. This is called a single. This is what a camellia would look like in the wild in China. And this is Camellia japonica. And we'll talk a little bit about right now about Camellia japonica. They tend to be large shrubs to small trees. They have medium-sized leaves that are dark green and glossy. And their peak of the bloom for japonica is January and February. There are some early flowering japonicas that will bloom as early as October, but the bulk of the Camellia japonicas bloom in January and February. Take a look at this next picture. This is a Camellia japonica as well, and this is another single flower. So this is called a single. It's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 petals. So 6 or 7 petals or so, and that is what you call a single. Let's take a look at our next picture. This is another Camellia japonica. Of course, they come in whites, reds, pinks. And this is what you would call a semi-double because it's got an extra set of petals. And again, you can recognize japonica by this leaf. It's kind of a medium-sized leaf and dark green. And then the formal double, well, let's take a look at this next one. This is Camellia japonica, another japonica. This is, let's see if we can get this flower up. Yeah, here we go. This is April, and I don't have the rest of it, but this is a semi-double. And I don't have the full name. Let's take a look at our next one, which is a hybrid, Camellia X. Willamsii. And this is another semi-double. Give you an idea what semi-doubles look like. Now we'll look at our next one, which is a formal double. And this is, actually this looks very much like a rose form formal double. And actually the rose form is a rose form semi-double. But this, you know, the forms intergrade. They're not chiseled in stone. So I'll just tell you what a rose form double, multiple layers of regular overlapping petals revealing a center cluster of stamens when flowers are fully open. Since you can't see any stamens in here at all, this is really a formal double. Formal doubles don't have any stamens and are sterile. You don't get any seed from them. Our next one is the anemone form. And let's take a look at that. This is anemone form, and this is Chandler's elegans, or just elegans. And you can see it has a row of petals on the outside that lay flat, and the stamens, which are usually yellow, are petaloid. They become little petals. You can see there's a regular stamen, that yellow one there, but most of them have become petaloid. This is called anemone form. Let's take a look at our next one and see if we can figure out the form on this. This looks like the peony form because it's got all the stamens of arcel petaloid, but they're all wiggly like this, and they call it rabbit ears. So this is, you know, could be a kind of integrating between peony and anemone form. Like I said, they're not chiseled in stone, they integrate between each other, and some varieties will have one form in one area of California and actually another form in a different area. Take a look at our next one. And this is Elegans Champagne. This is anemone form. And this is a sport. The Elegans all sported. We'll talk about sports in a minute. This is a particularly beautiful camellia with this row of flat petals and the petaloid stamens. And here's another picture of Elegant Champagne. I've got two pictures of it because it's one of my favorite camellias. So take a look at our next picture. This is also Elegant Champagne. These are very large, very showy camellias. Really, really something else. And let's take a look at our next one, which is another anemone form. And you can see the single row of petals on the background and the petaloid stamens. Now we'll take a look at some more formal doubles. And take a look at our next picture. And this is a formal double. Unfortunately, on my notes, most of the cultivar names have been cut off. So I can't tell you the name of this, but it is a spectacular camellia. You'll notice there's no stamens. Formal doubles don't have any stamens. Let's take a look at our next one. If we have the captions underneath, it'd be great to see them. This is a sweet olive. I think we might have skipped 15, but this is a formal double. Here we go. This is sweet olive? You know, this looks a little more like Joe Nuzio, but I'm not sure. But anyway, if you go up to Nuzio's nursery and you notice, this is sweet olive. This is, and of course it's a formal double. And it's really pretty. It's got a little cupping on the edges. It's, you know, pink, of course, and there's no stamens. Now let's take a look at our next formal double. This is another formal double. It looks a little like Nuzio's pearl, but I'm not sure if this is Nuzio's pearl or not. We'll talk a little bit about that name, Nuzio. And then let's take a look at our next one, another formal double. And this is one of the newer camellias. This is Bella Rosa from Nuzio's. Nuzio's is a camellia nursery up in Altadena, about 10 acres of camellias. I was just there this week. And the camellias are all in full bloom, go on up, and it's like going to a camellia flower show. Wonderful family. Family-owned nursery up in Altadena. And one of the great, great nurseries to visit to see the camellias. Now let's take a look at our next one, which is another formal double. Formal doubles are by far the most popular form. And I don't know if this may be another a sweet olive, but I'm not sure. And then let's take a look at our next one, which is probably Alba Plena, which is a white formal double. Alba Plena has a long history. It started out in Japan with a Japanese name. It went to Europe where it got a European name, probably I think a German name, and then it brought to the United States where it was given Alba Plena. And now let's take a look at the next one, which is a Reticulata Anne's Delight. And this is a peony form, a pure peony form. You don't see any flat petals along the side. So they're all rabbit-eared. They're all like this. There are stamens in the middle. And so this is peony form, and this is a Camellia reticulata. Now let's talk a little bit more about the three species that we're talking about. Let's talk about Camellia japonica. Camellia japonica, the peak flowering is December to January. Some cultivars, as I said, bloom early. They have dark green, shiny leaves, usually upright as a bush or a small tree. And let me just pull up a plant real quick. I've got a couple of Camellia japonicas here. This one is one that I have in my garden. This is Camellia japonica. This one is called a Blood of China. It's going to be a deep red. And it's covered with big buds. And they haven't opened yet, but this one right here is just starting to open right here. See a little tiny bit of color breaking. So within the next week, several of these buds will break and they'll open. It's a really pretty Blood of China, as I recall, it's a semi-double. And I want to show you the dark green, shiny leaves. Okay, dark green, shiny, and kind of a medium-sized leaf. And that's going to tell you you're dealing with either a Camellia japonica or certainly a Camellia japonica hybrid. So you can see how dark green the leaves are, a nice shiny green. So let me show you another one. Here, let's drag this one out. They're kind of big, so I keep them behind so that I can show them to you. This is a Spellbound And this is a, let's take a look at the flower here. And this is a semi-double, maybe showing a little peony influence. You know, like I said, the flower forms, we always want to stick everything in a box. This really is a semi-double, but it's got a little bit of peoniness to it there in the center. So this is called Spellbound, nice pink. Again, you can see the dark, shiny green leaves that aren't too large, indicating that it's a japonica. So this is Spellbound, Camellia japonica. So that's a nice camellia. I brought these originally in 1 gallon pots. I've moved them up into threes. They do best, of course, if you plant them in the ground and you plant them correctly. But you can grow them in pots. You can grow them in pots for a long time. So that's japonica. And the other very popular species is Camellia sasanqua. And sasanqua is fairly easy to tell the difference between japonicas and sasanquas. First off, they bloom in the fall. They'll start blooming in October, and by December they're done. And they typically have smaller flowers. Oh, I see I've got dirt all over the place. They have smaller flowers and smaller leaves. They have dark, shiny leaves, but they're smaller. I didn't bring in a sasanqua today. They tend, this is not, again, not chiseled in stone, but a lot of sasanquas tend to cascade. They come up and they weep. So they make smaller shrubs. They don't get quite as large as japonicas in general. But having said that, really about half the sasanquas are upright and about half are cascading. So you have to be, if that's you want a cascading one, make sure you get one that cascades, because they don't all cascade. And japonicas rarely cascade. Sasanquas can take a lot more full sun. Not japonica. Sasanquas are also called the sun camellia because they can take a lot of full sun. Red flowered camellias can always take more sun than white flowered camellias. The other thing is when a japonica flower falls off, it stays together like this. It's all the petals are fused at the base. See? Sasanquas aren't. The sasanqua flowers, the petals fall individually, and underneath your bush will be lots of little petals. And that makes it very popular in Japan. They like that a lot, that they rain down like raindrops, and then it's just really, really pretty. Whereas with japonicas, the whole flower falls and clump, clump, and then you need to clean them up, and I'll tell you why in a minute. The most popular camellia of all camellias is a sasanqua called Yuletide. It blooms, it's red, and it blooms in December, and it's upright, and we'll see a picture of that later in a video I have. The other popular species is Camellia reticulata, and reticulata is really more like a small tree than it is a thick shrub. Japonicas and sasanquas can be quite thick and full, and you can use them as screens, especially japonicas. They get really thick. But reticulatas are more like a small tree, and they don't really make that good a screen. They are native to the Yunnan province of southwestern China. Their peak of flowers is really January to March, but really March, February to March. So not a lot of them are blooming now, but there are some. But they bloom, you know, the sequence of blooming is sasanquas in the fall, japonicas in January, February, and reticulatas in February, March. And so you can have camellia blooming in your garden really for almost 6 months if you have several different species. A lot of the other species that I'm not going to talk about too much today just have little tiny white flowers. They're not particularly showy. That's why these three species are so popular. They have large showy flowers. The reticulata, the peak of bloom is February, but they have very large flowers. They can be as big as a small plate, and very, very showy. They have larger leaves, much larger than the japonica leaves, and they're not shiny green, they're a dull green. So they're not dark, shiny green, they're dull green. The early varieties were from Buddhist temples in China, and like I said, it tends to be more like a tree, open and loosely branched, rather than a thick shrub. The other species that I mentioned earlier is Camellia sinensis, which is native to Southeast Asia and grew out throughout the world as for the source of tea, green tea and black tea. It has small white flowers. You can make white tea, green tea, black tea. They all come from Camellia sinensis. There's a couple of different cultivated varieties. Sinensis means Chinese in Latin. The young, light green leaves are used for the tea. You don't pick the old hard enough. You pick the new growth for the tea. And then you either let it dry and stay green, and that's green tea, or you crush it and heat it, and it turns black. And they call that fermenting, but it's not really fermented. But that makes it black, and you get black tea. It is cultivated for the most part in tropical and subtropical climates. It's kind of hard to grow in Southern California. I tried to grow them at the Huntington, and they really suffered. They do quite well in cool, moist climates, not so much in Southern California. You know, the big tea plantations are in India and Sri Lanka. And the three main tea-producing regions in India are Darjeeling, Assam, and Nilgiri. Darjeeling, considered to be the best Indian tea due to excellent growing conditions, uses the Chinese variety Sinensis, Assam is the largest producing area in India, producing 473,000 metric tons annually, and that may be a long time ago. The large-leaved Assamese plant, Camellia sinensis assamica, is used mainly for black tea. And the seeds of Camellia sinensis and Camellia oleifera are pressed for oil. And you, if you go to Japan, you could buy Camellia oil. It's used both to cook with and to treat wood as a preservative, just as any oil could be used. It has a sweetest, it's kind of a sweet oil when you use it when cooking. Now, let's take a look at how long this next video is. And let's go to our first video on camellias. And take a look at this short video clip from YouTube. And when we come back, we'll talk more about camellias.
Nicholas Stadden, and I work for Monrovia. And you're probably wondering, why is he standing there in his dark glasses? Well, we're in a kind of a shady position. We are here with a beautiful group of camellias in a shade house. And so let's talk about the two different groups of camellias first of all. The first group are called japonicas. Japonicas tend to be more upright in stature. They have larger leaves. They have larger flowers of many different sizes and colors, and they like to be in a dappled shade or full shade position. Then there are the sasanquas. The sasanquas are autumn or sometimes into the Christmas season bloomers. They tend to have smaller leaves. They will do in some sun. They don't mind a dappled shade position. They have smaller flowers, and depending on the variety, all different types of colors. And they're very, very foliferous. They're just beautiful plants. And we're going to talk about two brand new varieties. The first brand new variety is called Marge Miller, and she is the world's first prostrate or ground cover camellia. You can have this plant trailing over a wall in your border. She has lovely semi-double soft pink flowers and is very, very foliferous. And so she's an autumn bloomer, a great addition to any garden. You could use them even trailing over a rock wall. Great. The main reason we're here is to talk about something truly extraordinary in the world of horticulture, and it's a camellia. Yuletide is normally a red camellia, and it blooms in the late autumn on into Christmas, alias the name Yuletide. What we're looking at today is a pink Yuletide. Her flower is soft pink, large yellow stamens in the middle, and, ladies and gentlemen, this is a fragrant camellia. It is so rare and unusual to find a fragrant camellia. It's almost like finding the Holy Grail, which is why I call her a whiz banger. So look for pink Yuletide and look for Marge Miller. These are great plants. This has been another Plant Savvy Tip from Nicholas Stadden at Monrovia.
So that was a good point he made, that camellias, for the most part, are not scented flowers. Camellia japonicas are not scented. That being said, Camellia sinensis, sasanqua, Camellia sasanqua. is scented, but they all have the same scent, and they're actually pretty heavily scented. Then there are some others that are scented. Some other species are scented, and there's one called Fragrance, that Nuzio sells up in Altadena, and it's a real hot seller. Little white flowers, but very fragrant. And so one of the things that nurserymen do and horticulturalists are doing is crossing japonicas with the fragrant camellias, trying to get fragrance in camellias. Roses have wonderful fragrance for the most part. Not all roses, but many. But camellias, for the most part, are not scented. Reticulatas aren't scented, japonicas aren't scented, and sasanquas all have the same scent, and it's a nice scent. Some people don't like it too much, but I like it. It's nice in the fall. If you visit the Huntington Gardens in October or November and walk through the camellia gardens where they have most of the sasanquas, it's a very, very nice scent, a very nice aroma. But there's some others that are really nicely scented, and of course they're trying to get that. The other thing is to get a yellow camellia or a blue camellia. There are some yellow camellia species, but it's difficult to cross them into japonicas, sasanquas, and retics. So we were talking a little bit about tea, and let's just talk about how tea was discovered. There are some legends about how tea was discovered in China. One of the popular Chinese legends is that a legendary emperor, an inventor of agriculture, his name was Xin Yong, if I hope I pronounced that correctly, and he was also the inventor of Chinese medicine, was drinking a bowl of boiling water sometime around 2737 BC. I'm surprised they don't have that exact time of day. When a few leaves were blown from a nearby tree into his water, changing the color, the emperor took a sip of the brew and was pleasantly surprised by its flavor and restorative properties. Now, tea, of course, has caffeine in it. So if you drink a cup of black tea, you'll get a little caffeine and you'll get a little buzz. A different legend says that this one is a rather gruesome legend, dates back to the Tang Dynasty. In the legend, Bodhidharma, the founder of Chan Buddhism, accidentally fell asleep after meditating in front of a wall for 9 years. He woke up in such disgust at his weakness that he cut off his own eyelids. They fell to the ground and took root, growing into tea bushes. So that one I don't believe too much. Yunnan province has also been identified as the birthplace of tea. The first area where humans figured out that eating tea leaves or brewing a cup could be pleasant. the home of the oldest world's cultivated tea tree, believed to be 3,200 years old, is in Lingcheng City in the prefecture of Yunnan province. So there are trees, camellias, that are easily over 100 years old, but this one is supposed to be 3,200 years old. That's pretty old. Now, tea came to Japan later. The Chinese drank tea for a long time before the Japanese ever knew it existed. So there's a variety of dates. In 1191, a Zen priest brought back tea seeds to Kyoto. Some of the tea seeds were given to the priest and became the basis for Yuji tea, the oldest tea specialty book in Japan. How to Stay Healthy by Drinking Tea was written by the Zen priest, and if I pronounce his name right, it's Issei. I'm not sure how to pronounce it. The two-volume book was written in 1211, after his second and last visit to China. The first sentence states, tea is the ultimate mental and medical remedy and has the ability to make one's life more full and complete. I must believe that because I had a cup of Earl Grey this morning. Tea use spread to Japan about the 6th century, which is hard, you know, here you got two different dates. One says it wasn't brought back to 1191, but actually it had to be before that. Tea became a drink of the religious classes in Japan when Japanese priests and envoys sent to Japan to learn about its culture brought tea back to Japan. It became a drink of the royal classes when Emperor Saga, the Japanese emperor, encouraged the growth of tea plants. Now, tea is also grown in Vietnam. Lotus tea is especially a product of the Vietnamese tea industry. Generally, high-quality green tea leaves are placed within lotus flowers for a day to acquire the scent. Taiwan is also well known for its tea. for the making of oolong tea and green tea, as well as many Western-styled teas. Now, of course, today, tea is considered a very English drink. All of England drinks tea. And how did that happen? Well, the importing of tea into Britain began in the 1660s with the marriage of King Charles II with his Portuguese princess, Catherine of Braganza, where she brought to the court the habit of drinking tea. The importing of tea into Britain began in the 1660s. By the end of the 17th century, tea was taken as a drink, I'll bet mainly by the aristocracy, because it had to all be brought back on a boat. They weren't growing it, and the Chinese didn't let much out. By 1750, tea would be the national drink. Merchantmen ships delivered fabrics manufactured in Britain to India and China, but would return empty or partially full. To solve this problem, the East India Company began a vigorous public relations campaign to popularize tea among the common people in Britain and develop it as a viable return cargo. Britain had to pay China for its tea, but China had little need for British goods, so much of it was paid for with silver bullion. As an alternative, Britain began producing opium in India and forced China to trade tea for opium as part of several treaties after the Opium Wars. So, you know, tea, which is camellia, really is an important plant in the history of Europe and Japan and really the whole world. People were traveling all over the world looking for spices. Tea was one of them. It's why the Europeans were taken off in these little boats and traveling around the world. This day, tea is seen as a symbol of Britishness, but also to some as a symbol of British colonization. And of course, tea has a huge page in American history. The American specialty tea market has quadrupled in the years from 1993 to 2008, now being worth about $6.8 billion a year. But more importantly, of course, is the Boston Tea Party. It was an act of direct action protest by the American colonists against the British government, in which they destroyed many crates of tea belonging to the British East India Company on ships in Boston Harbor. The incident, which took place on Thursday, December 16, 1773, has been seen as helping to spark the American Revolution and remains to this day one of the most iconic events in American history. So, you didn't realize how important camellia was to American history. And you've got them growing in your backyard, probably. Not tea plants, but Camellia japonicas. Tea is, you know what, before I go on, I want to stop here for just a minute for station identification. We want to take a short break to remind everyone about our TV station, which is DHTV, broadcast from Cal State University, Dominguez Hills. Let's take a short break for station ID. I hope I didn't cap off.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. Did you know that in the first three quarters of this year, there were nearly 34,000 permitted production days of filmed content shot on location by crews just like this all around Los Angeles? While the production crew behind me is following safety protocols, that's not always the case. And the further a crew goes outside the 30-mile zone, the greater chance someone will get hurt. CSU Dominguez Hills has the only OSHA Training Institute Education Center in the LA Basin. We offer a certificate program designed for the specific needs of the film and television industry. Make sure your next production is safe. For more information, visit our website, csudh.edu/OSHA. That's csudh.edu/OSHA.
You ought to be congratulated on undertaking a sometimes difficult but always rewarding task of earning your college education. You are here and you are in for a great ride. You have to want to be successful.
Learn more and you will succeed and excel.
Go Toros!
You can be the class of 2018 that changed the world.
You can do that because you're at CSU Dominguez Hills.
At Dominguez Hills, we want you to get better.
You are in control of your destiny.
Do well, go Toros.
Hello, my name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
My name is Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
Hello, my name is Lira Harding. I'm a junior at California State University Dominguez Hills. The reason why I chose this university was for small classes and interactive programs.
Hi, I'm Bruce Betts, Director of Projects for the Planetary Society, and I'm here at Planetary Society headquarters in Pasadena, California, talking to you about the Young Scholars Program and my introduction to Planetary Science and Astronomy class at California State University Dominguez Hills. One of the main things Planetary Society does is educate and inspire the public about space and space exploration.
So science education is the key to our future, not just California. Not just the United States, but the world, and I'm not kidding, because we have enormous problems to solve around the world, and to understand them and to solve them, we're going to need scientists and engineers, and this is what the Planetary Society does, is get people excited about science through space. We try to advance space science and exploration, really, for the betterment of all humankind, and it all adds up. So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
I've been a guest at the Cal State Dominguez Hills distance learning classes and been able to talk about my research on Venus and Mars, but also on all of the really cool research that's being done on planets all over the solar system by the active missions that are out there right now. I think that it's really fun to be able to share the adventure of exploring the solar system with audience, with all different kinds of people coming from all different places, whether they're adults or kids, current students, or people who were last students a long time ago.
In the case of this class, to be able to actually not only reach out to new audiences, but provide detail information and really share what is an inherently visual type of science, planetary science, with TV.
At Cal State Dominguez Hills, like at any university, our primary mission is to educate students. Through the Young Scholars Program, we at CSUDH are partnering with the Planetary Society to get high school students from around the state of California interested in science and careers in science even before they enter college. In so doing, we stay involved with our local community and make opportunities available to these students that they might not otherwise get.
So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
I think they rose to the occasion.
Dude, love, love, love. Brother, love, that Mandarin love. Sauce is ridiculous. The heat was fantastic. I enjoyed the flavors.
Our champion is the Literal.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. And this is the live garden show broadcast where you can call in and ask questions about your gardens. I'm a plant pathologist and a certified arborist and a pest control advisor and worked in botanical gardens and now run a plant diagnostic clinic for the County of Los Angeles, agricultural commissioner. So give us a call at 800-339-1193 and we'll talk about your garden. If you've had a problem, if there's a tree you're interested in, if you want to talk about growing vegetables, whatever you want to talk about, give us a call. Today we're talking about camellias. We've been talking a little bit about tea, but let's get back to the ornamentals. We've talked a lot about tea. And let's take a look at this. Now there is one other flower form. It's really a single. I mentioned the six flower forms for camellias. Singles, semi-doubles, peony, formal double, anemone. What's the sixth one? I've left one off. You got a single, anemone, formal double, and rose form double, and peony and semi-double. So let's take a look at this, because there's one other actually, it's called Higo. And Higo is really a single, but it's a special kind of single. And I have a little short clip here. It's our second video clip from the North Fork Botanical Garden. And they're gonna talk a little bit about Higos. This is a short clip. Let's go to this clip. And then when we come back, we'll talk about more about camellias.
Today I'm in the Hoffheimer Camellia Garden, and this is about the best time of year to be here because one of our garden's signature plants, the camellia, is in full bloom. We have over 1,700 camellias here at the Norfolk Botanical Gardens, and most of them are concentrated here. The number of camellia varieties is almost overwhelming, and I couldn't possibly show them all to you, but there is one group I want to mention, and that's the Higo group. And these are also known as the samurai camellia. During the feudal ages of Japan, the samurais collected these camellias. They were grown in their gardens, at monasteries, and planted on their grave sites, and they were handed down from generation to generation. The Higos were valued for a number of reasons, primarily for the large number of stamens right here in the center that kind of look like a sunburst. They were also appreciated for their shorter petals, and also for the fact that they drop cleanly off the plant when the blossom is spent. If you'd like to learn more about Higos and other camellias, then you should come out to the Botanical Gardens this Saturday when the Virginia Camellia Society is having their annual spring show. You'll be able to purchase camellias for your own garden and see which blooms won the best awards. I'm Les Parks, and I hope to see you in the garden soon.
So those are Higos, and of course, a real Higo is that ball of stamens will be about a third of the flower. It takes up a lot of the flower, because a lot of times you'll have a single or even a semi-double with a lot of stamens, but they're really not Higo form. So there's really true Higos and things that approach it. But like I said, these flower forms integrate. So you could have a semi-double that kind of integrates to a rose form semi-double, depending on where you grow it. Now, how do you grow them? How do you water them? How do you plant them? Now, camellias do need to be in an acid soil, and you often hear the term acid-loving plants, and they don't really love anything, but they do require an acid soil. And why? Well, because the solubility of iron is governed by the pH in the soil. So if it is a soil is pH 7 and you lower it to a pH 6, you increase iron solubility by tenfold. And the exact opposite, if you go to from 7 to 8, you decrease iron solubility by tenfold. So there's certain plants that just will not take up iron if they're in an alkaline soil. Above 7. Most acid-loving plants need to be between about a 5.5 and a 6.5 pH. Some really would like to be down as low as 4.5. And what plants really require acid soils? Well, blueberries, azaleas, camellias, rhododendrons, gardenias, we call them acid-loving. And it's all based on iron solubility. And if you've never noticed your azaleas turn yellow, it's almost certainly from iron deficiency. And you can recognize iron deficiency in most plants because the new growth will be yellow and the old growth will stay green because iron can't be moved from old growth to new growth. So that's telling you, you look at your azaleas and you see the new growth is coming out and it's yellow, it's not dark green. And the old growth is still dark green. That's probably iron deficiency, almost certainly iron deficiency. Now sometimes the whole bush turns yellow because you have so little iron that the whole thing goes yellow. Well, you got to give it a little nitrogen, a little iron, keep treating it about once a month or every few months, and then slowly green it up. They won't respond in the winter, but they do respond quite well in the spring and the summer to iron and nitrogen applications. So how do you plant the hole? No deeper than the root ball. This is true whether you're planting a tree or any shrub. You want to dig the hole as deep as the root ball, or maybe a little less, so that the root ball or the top of the soil from the pot sticks up about an inch above grade. You want to dig a wide hole, and so that the soil around the root ball is going to be loose and broken up, so you can grow some roots into it. If you've got a root-bound pot, you can slice through it or loosen the roots a little so they'll grow out from the root ball. You can backfill the hole with half peat moss, and peat moss is very acid. So you do want to mix a nice coarse peat. A fine peat won't last as long as a coarse peat. And then mix it 50-50 with the soil, and then fill in the hole with that. So you have a lot of peat moss in the hole. You need to water once a week for the first year, whether you're planting a citrus or an avocado or a camellia. You put in a tree or a shrub, water it once a week for 1 year, or maybe even a year and a half or so. But as soon as it starts to get established and it's growing roots in the soil and starting to send out shoots, you don't have to water that frequently. So generally, For camellias, I would water them twice a month in spring and fall and once a week in the summer, especially if you're in a hot inland valley. Now, if you're along the coast, you might be able to get away with watering your camellias once a month in March, April, May, maybe twice in June and July, and then once a week in August, September. Fertilize with a low nitrogen fertilizer about three times a year, spring, summer, fall. And so you very much treat a camellia like you would treat an orange tree or any citrus. You want to deep water them, and this is true for shrubs and trees. It doesn't matter what you're talking about. You deep water them and let them dry out for 2 to 4 weeks, maybe 1 week in August and September when it's particularly hot. But if you water something two or three times a week, like a shrub or a tree, and you're watering it constantly and keeping the soil wet all the time, you're going to get root rot. You're going to get soil-borne diseases, and your plants are going to suffer and do quite badly. Now, you can maintain the acidity in the soil by mulching with peat moss or applying acidifying fertilizers. Iron sulfate will also acidify the soil and increase the iron, and you get really dark green plants if you use iron sulfate, or you could also use a chelated iron product like ironite. I like to use non-soluble forms of nitrogen when I'm fertilizing trees and shrubs. The reason is that non-soluble nitrogen sources take about 2 months to release the nitrogen into the soil, and the plants get a slow, continuous feed over about 2 months. So in March, you put out a little bit of either cottonseed meal or a mixture of cottonseed meal, blood meal. The old formula was 4 parts cottonseed meal, 1 part blood meal. Of course, there's also bone meal and kelp meal. Bone meal is mostly phosphorus. But the point is, the nitrogen in cottonseed meal or blood meal is non-soluble. It has to break down and be released, and it takes 1 or 2 months for that to happen. Conventional fertilizers, things like Miracle-Gro or Miracid or all these standard fertilizers, look at the ingredients. What is in the package? It's ammonium sulfate, it's calcium nitrate, it's urea. These are fully water-soluble sources of nitrogen. When you take that blue powder, and I have it, I use it on my orchids. It's cheap. It's cheaper than cottonseed meal, so I use it sometimes. But if you're going to use that, remember, it's water-soluble. You take a tablespoon, you put it in a gallon of water, and now it's dissolved, and that nitrogen is all available right now. When you pour it on the soil and fertilize your tree or shrub, you're going to give it a big blast of nitrogen. So you can use it half strength and use it twice as often, and that will be very similar to what happens when you use a non-soluble form of nitrogen, which is a slower, lower amount of nitrogen available over a longer period of time. It's much better for plants to fertilize that way. It's much easier to give them too much and burn them if you're using water-soluble forms of nitrogen. Camellias are low feeders, as are azaleas, gardenias, blueberries, things like that. They're low feeders. They're not like roses and orchids, which are high feeders. Citrus is kind of moderate to high. Avocados, probably low, really. So you don't want to pound them with nitrogen. You want to give them just a little bit and keep a consistent amount of nitrogen available all the time instead of applying a bunch of nitrogen and it shoots up and then it crashes. And you apply a bunch and it shoots up and it crashes. And that's rough on plants, and it's not the best way to fertilize. Now there's another problem that camellias get. There's a couple problems that camellias get, but before I talk about those problems, let's take a look at growing camellias. This is a little video clip from Australia, and they talk about growing camellias. There's a couple things they say that I probably wouldn't agree with, but let's take a look at this clip because they have got some good information. The Garden Gurus, growing camellias, and he'll talk a little bit more about what they need and how to plant them.
Garden plants, and certainly gardening here in many parts of Australia. They're versatile, hardy, and apart from their glossy dark green leaves, produce some awesome flowers in the cooler months, when the garden can otherwise be a little dull. There are thousands of camellia cultivars bred from Camellia reticulata, japonica, and Sasanqua, the main three ornamental species. As a general rule, camellias perform best in light shade or filtered sun. Many of your Sasanqua hybrids, though, can cop full sun all day, but always check this before buying. Not all of them like the afternoon heat. By the way, Sasanquas make excellent hedging plants, responding well to pruning. Like with all your plants, getting the soil right is crucial for success, and camellias like a slightly acidic soil with reliable moisture and good drainage. So it's important before you plant to prepare the soil with an acidic organic matter, something like composted leaves, cow manure, or the cocoa peat. You'll be glad you did, and so will this guy. It's a Camellia japonica, maroon and gold, and it's a ripper. To ensure your plants get that reliable moisture, this is also a good time to mix through some water crystals. Trust me, you'll be glad you did, because these guys can really help in the warmer months and save you water too. Once you've got the plant in the ground, water in well and spread a thick layer of organic mulch to retain moisture and keep the roots protected against high and low temperatures. As camellias mature, the growth can become very crowded, so to keep them looking good, you might just want to thin out the middle of the plant with some pruning to increase air circulation. And as a general rule with camellia pruning, you do it after flowering. Removing excess flower buds can increase the size of the blooms. Leave just one bud in a cluster and allow the plant to put all its energy into that single flower. Now, with hedges, you need regular pruning to keep things nice and straight, because that'll promote dense growth and keep your bush looking nice and tight. Now, the other thing that'll promote dense growth is feeding, and that's important with camellias. And one of the best things to use is the new Yates Dynamic Lifter Advanced for camellias, azaleas and rhododendrons. The natural manure component in this plant food feeds gently and at the same time encourages microbial activity in the soil. Perfect. And it's been specifically formulated for acid-loving plants like camellias. Keeping your camellias healthy will reduce the invasion of pests and diseases. However, you may still get the odd uninvited nasty guest. But don't panic, help is at hand. Sucking insects such as scale, thrips and aphids can be controlled with Confidor, a low-toxic systemic insecticide. In fact, this is good to use as a preventative pest control too, before the pests even show up. One thing your camellias don't like is extreme heat. It can really knock them around, but you can give them some protection with something like Drought Shield, which is a bit like sunscreen for plants. It's good gear. What it does is covers the foliage and then holds in moisture by reducing transpiration. And that's what you want in the heat. It's also excellent if you're going to transplant. Get it on the plant, move the plant, and it'll just help the plants get through those difficult times. And let's face it, plants don't want difficult times. They want the good times, baby.
So he, you know, was promoting a couple of products, but, you know, I'm not here to promote specific products. Just tell you which products are appropriate and which aren't, and it's more of a class of products than it is specific products. So you can get cottonseed meal from a lot of different people, although it's not that widely available, to tell you the truth. If you go to some of the big box stores, I haven't seen it there. Now, I've mentioned Nuzio's Nurseries. The reason I mentioned Nuzio's is one of the last specialty nurseries that grows camellias and azaleas exclusively. They have some palms, too, but and gardenias, but there's 10 acres of mostly camellias and azaleas. And it was formed, the nursery was formed by Julius Nuzio and his brother Joe back in about 1930. And then it, back then, I think it was in Temple City. And then they, at some point, they bought the property up in Altadena, and they actually own 40 acres, but they use 10 acres for their nursery. Now, Julius and Joe aren't running the nursery anymore. Julius, I think, is 97 years old. But his two sons, Tom and Jim, and their cousin, Julius, who's Joe's son, they are running the nursery, and it's a wonderful nursery. They're closed Wednesdays and Thursdays. They're up in Altadena. Really helpful. They'll show you around, show you all the flowers, talk about how to grow them. They sell cottonseed meal because cottonseed meal is the preferred fertilizer for most camellia enthusiasts. But you don't have to use that. There's other fertilizers. I just prefer it myself too. I use it on all my citrus and my avocado and things like that. Now on my orchids, I use a soluble fertilizer, but they are high feeders. But I do it at less than the label rate, at a weaker solution. So remember, you dig a wide hole not a deep hole. You want that root ball to stick up about an inch above grade. You want to backfill with a mixture of half peat moss and half soil. You want to lightly fertilize. You want to water once a week for the first year, or a year and a half to even 2 years, depending on where you live. You want to make sure you have good drainage. You do not want to keep camellias in soggy, wet soil all the time. It will be a disaster. The number one thing that kills camellias and a lot of plants in your garden is Phytophthora root rot. And Phytophthora is water mold. Now, let's see, do we have a caller? I don't know if we've got a caller yet or not. But let's just talk a little bit. Let's go to our first caller, if we've got Terry on the line. Hello? Terry, you're on the air. I can't hear Terry. Is she on the line? I guess, well, we'll have to see what's, maybe there's something wrong technically. But let's talk a little bit about some of the problems that camellias get and see if we can get in touch with Terry from Pasadena. Let's take a little close-up of this leaf. Now, I cut this off this morning off of camellias in my mom's yard next door to my house, and I want to show you what's wrong with this. If we can go to the overhead. One of the things that camellias get is a camellia mite. And the mites, now let's take a look at this. You can see that right down the middle of this, it's kind of bronzed right in here. And if I reach over here and just pluck off one of these new leaves off one of my camellias, and let's compare it. And you can compare it here. You see how nice and even and dark green that is. This one has no mite feeding. This one was fed on by mites. And you see the bronzing that's right down the middle. And this isn't as bad, it can get worse. And you can see on every one of these leaves, they're kind of bronzed. And if we compare it to a healthy leaf, look at the difference. A nice dark green leaf with no damage. This is the camellia mite. It is an areophyted mite. Areophyted mites are the strangest little mites. And most of them cause galls, but this one doesn't. And this is easily controlled with oils or soaps. Oils can be used in the spring months. You want to get on it in spring when you get the new growth. You want to really control it. It'll just really make your foliage look very poor. So you got to get on that early in March with some oils or soaps. I see we have a phone call. Let's go to our caller. Do we have our caller?
Hello?
Hello, you're on the air.
I have a question about peach trees. I wanted to plant a peach tree, and I was wondering what kind of peaches do well in Southern California.
Well, that's a great question. And I earlier in the show, I actually showed a guide, the edible fruit guide from Ellie Cook. And what you really want to do is pick a peach tree that will doesn't need too much chill. If you're in Pasadena, then you're looking at about a cutoff at about 500 hours of chill. If it needs more than that, you're taking a risk. Although peaches aren't that finicky like some of the others. And let me just look here at some of the peaches in this. I'm looking right here at this Ellie Cook Edible Fruit Descriptive Guide. And they've got 0 to 350 hours. They've got Early Grand, Desert Gold, Tropic Snow only needs 175 hours. That's something you could grow in Santa Monica and it would flower. Now the thing about chill, it's called vernalization. It's hours below 45 degrees during the winter that forces the tree into dormancy so that when it comes out in the spring, it flowers vigorously. If you don't get that winter chill, it may not flower at all, which means you'll get no fruit.
Oh, okay.
So they've got several right in here in this first group of 0 to 350. Rubidoux, Shanghai, Santa Barbara, Four Star, Daily. And then they've in the 400 to 700 hours, they've got Springtime, Techstar, Rio Grande. You also need to decide if you want a freestone or a cling, and you want to decide when you want it to ripen because they all have different ripening dates. They can ripen as early as May. A lot of these earlier ones that I mentioned ripen in May. Others will ripen in June. So I would go online to the Ellie Cook website and read about as many as you can. You can also read in the Sunset Western Garden book on peaches, and they'll give you the vernalization and a description of the fruit.
Okay.
Some of the old standbys. Babcock is a very popular, it's a white-fleshed, but very, very flavorful at 450 hours, and it ripens in July, so that's mid-season.
Oh, okay.
Now, some of these others...
That sounds like a good suggestion.
Yeah, I love Babcock. It's really wonderful. I'm just looking for some of the others I remember offhand. And giant Babcock is white flesh. A lot of them are yellow. Let me see if... this is just a little table. They don't give all the varieties. Here's a cling peach ripening and chilling chart. June Gold is 650. That's kind of a difficult one. It's yellow flesh, but it's a cling peach. Most people prefer a freestone anyway, where the seed isn't attached to the flesh. But that's the thing you got to look out for. You got to look out for getting a variety that requires too much chill, and then decide when you want to pick the fruit, because you can get early season, mid-season, or late season ripening. I like the earlier season because I avoid some problems with some insect pests by picking fruit in May and June. The longer it's on the tree, the longer you have a chance of something going wrong. And you might also look at disease resistance, although they don't talk about that a lot here, because you get a variety of diseases on peaches that can be a big problem. But not so much. They're more nuisance diseases in Southern California than serious diseases. Okay?
Okay, well, thank you so much for that information. I enjoy your show.
Okay, well, thank you for watching, and thank you for calling. So, the edible fruit descriptive guide from Ellie Cook. This is my last one of these. I had a whole bunch of them, and I passed them out to a lot of people over the years. But I also printed it out online. But you don't need to print it. Just go back and read it again. So you can pick out a variety and then go to your local nursery and see if they've got it, or ask them to order it for you if there's a specific variety you're really interested in. But just... if you go to the nursery, you can just look at the tag. It'll say right on the tag how many hours of chill it needs. Don't buy anything that needs more than 500 hours, mostly in Southern California. If you're right down at the beach, I would not get anything that needs more than 300 hours. Some of them are as low as 175. I did put in a peach in my backyard called a Katy, which it needed 150 hours. But I got to tell you, I was very disappointed in the flavor. Was not that good a peach. So that's the other thing. Make sure you get a really delicious peach. Don't sacrifice flavor just to get a bigger yield, but you still need to get pay attention to that vernalization. Let's talk now about diseases. And the biggest problem on camellias, other than root rot and watering too frequent, which is Phytophthora root rot. Phytophthora is a water mold. It's best considered to be a parasitic algae. It's not a fungus. Affects the roots. On the outside of the roots, it makes microscopic sacs that have spores in them. Every time you saturate the soil, those sacs release their spores that swim. That's why it's a water mold. They need a lot of wet soil or wet conditions in order to do well, but they like lots of water. So they swim to another root, start a new infection. The longer the soil is saturated, the more frequently you saturate the soil, the more severe the root rot becomes, and eventually the plant will start doing very poorly. It won't grow well in the spring. It won't set flowers. The flowers may be set, but they won't open. Another thing they can do is bullnosing. These are all symptoms that there's something wrong with the whole plant, and usually root rot. So you control root rot by your, number one, irrigation practices. Number two, spreading gypsum underneath the plant, which is calcium sulfate. High calcium levels inhibit Phytophthora. Then covering that with 4 inches of compost or peat moss, especially for camellias. Peat moss, very acidic, and keeps the soil acidified, but also suppresses Phytophthora. You can also treat with specific chemicals like Aliette or Subdue, but that might not be necessary if you're doing everything else right. Now, the next really bad problem is camellia flower blight. Well, before we go on to that, let's just show you the yellow camellia, which is a Camellia chrysantha, the golden camellia. Let's bring that up, number 21. Bring it up full screen. This is the yellow camellia. It is a species camellia, but Nuzios has crossed it and has several yellow camellias. And they're not easy to cross with Japonica. The next one is kind of yellow, is called Buttermint. And that's our next picture. And you can see there's a little yellow in it. Not really, really yellow, but this is one of the crosses they've achieved using Camellia chrysantha. Chrysantha. And then let's take a look at Camellia sinensis, which is our next picture. This is the tea plant, and you can see it just has little, it has white flowers and kind of pronounced ribbing in the leaves. Let's take a look at a tea plantation in India, which is our next picture. Now, what they do is they just pick the newest leaves. They don't pick the old leaves. And so this is all tea plants. And, of course, they need lots of rain and nice and cool weather and acid soils. And usually if you get lots of rain, then you have more acid soils anyway. And then take a look at the tea plant leaves, which is number 25. And you can, this is flower blight. Let's go back a picture and take a look at the leaves for tea plants. The first 25, there we go. We have two number 25s. So when they're picking the new leaves, when they're picking for tea, they're picking the very newest growth, not these old leaves down here. They don't make as good a tea, too bitter. So they just pick the new growth. Now let's talk about Camellia flower blight, which you just saw. A flower infected. This is Camellia flower blight. And each one of these brown spots is an infection by a fungus. And that fungus is called Siberinia camellii. It was introduced into California in 1937. This flower will quickly, within a few days, this whole flower will turn brown. Let's take a look at the next picture. And you can see that now the petals are completely brown, and within another few days, even these petals will turn brown. So the flower then falls on the ground, and the base of the flower turns into what we call sclerotia. And the sclerotia are little black fungal tissue. In this case, it's fungal tissue mixed with the petal tissue. So in a technical sense, maybe they're not sclerotia, but for all of our purposes, let's call them sclerotia. And let's take a look at some of the sclerotia. This is our next picture, flower blight sclerotia. Many fungi make sclerotia, and they are survival structures. Because the camellias flower in the winter. And the only part of the plant that's really susceptible is the flower. So once the flowers are gone, this fungus, Siberinia, it needs to survive somehow. So it produces these sclerotia that kind of look like rat droppings. And the flower falls to the ground. The base of the flower turns into these sclerotia. The petals rot away, but the sclerotia remain. They sit there all summer. In the spring, when it starts to rain, they germinate and grow these little cups. Let's take a look at the next picture. And you'll see these little cups that are like mushrooms, and they're called apothecia. And these are little cups, you see, and these are all sclerotia in here. And then these little things grow, and it's a cup. It's a cup like this, with a stem down to the sclerotia. And lining this are microscopic sacs, like this. And so the sacs look like this. And inside there are spores. I don't know if I draw a big one. There are spores inside the sacs. Eight, I can only show you four here. When you bump them, the tip comes off and these are shot out and you'll see smoke. It looks like smoke, it's actually spores. Coming up out of the cup. They float off in the air and they land on the petals and infect the petals. So, this disease was introduced into California in 1937, and prior to that, camellias were used for corsages. And come on back to me. And they were used as corsages. And so you would pick camellias, and Descanso Gardens was originally planted for cut flowers to sell the camellias as corsages and as cut flowers. But as soon as this disease was introduced, the camellia flower blight, you would pick a beautiful flower and put it in a box and mail it to somebody in New York. When they opened it, it was brown and rotted. So it destroyed the camellia flower industry as a cut flower. And if we have dry weather, sunny and warm, and the flower opens under those conditions, you'll get little or no blight. If it's raining all the time and it's really humid, then you get totally blighted. So I got a couple flowers here that don't have any blight. This is a one that I picked this morning off a shrub in my mom's yard that I transplanted into her yard many, many years ago. This is a formal double. I've lost the name. It didn't have the name when I dug it up originally. But you notice there's no blight. It's nice and white, and there's nothing wrong with it. And this one is called Silver Wave. Here is Silver Wave. It's a really wonderful semi-double. And it doesn't have any blight either. These opened in the last few days when it was warm and dry, and so there's no blight. Now, okay, here we go. Let me show you a blighted flower that actually came off this Spellbound. Let's go to the overhead. And this is another semi-double, the Spellbound. I don't think it's peony form, it's semi-double. Let's go to the overhead. See if you can, now this is a little washed out. This is a formal double. Can we get it a little closer? Because you can see the flower bite getting going on these petals. And so what do you do? Well, first off, you have to pick up your flowers and throw them in the trash, because that's where the fungus is. It's in the flowers. So if you pick them all up, so you can see here that there's these lesions on these petals right here. Let's just pluck that off and put that in my hand. And you can see the infection on these petals. They're kind of brown. And you can see it even better here. You can see all this brown that's right in here. This is camellia flower blight. It's just getting started. But very quickly, the fungus will grow in about, 3 days, 4 days, and the whole thing turns brown. And so, and then this is, this doesn't have any on it, and this doesn't have any on it, because these didn't open while it was raining. Now, because camellias are so common in Southern California, you really can't avoid the spores. They're everywhere. And if you live in Pasadena, there's millions of camellias, and most people aren't picking up their flowers. And so starting in the fall, as soon as we get rain, then these those sclerotia will germinate and produce that little tube, that little stem with a little cup on the end, and then shoot the spores in the air. They float around, land on an open flower, and if it's humid and been raining, it'll start an infection. During dry weather, you get very little infection. Let's take a look at this next picture, which is our last picture for today, that shows an individual apothecia. And then we'll talk just briefly about, bring this up full screen. Here's the sclerotia right there, and here's the apothecia right here. And the spores shoot out like this. And there's a bunch of fungi that have forced ejection of spores. And they're pretty cool to see. If you are one of the things I always like to do when I was giving tours at the Huntington of the camellia collection is I would dig these up from underneath the camellias and show people them puffing spores, which is fun to see. So if you live in proximity to the Descanso or Huntington in this Pasadena area, you're going to be inundated with the spores. It's really not, all you can hope is that you don't get too much blight. There's no spray or treatment that really works because the flowers don't all open at once. If the flowers would all open at once, as soon as they start to open, you could spray with a fungicide two or three times and coat the petals with a fungicide, a surface or a protectant, a foliar protectant. And that would probably work, but it doesn't work because one flower is open today. A few days later, another flower opens. A few days later, another flower opens. So if camellias flower over a month or two and slowly open flowers a few at a time, you'd have to constantly be spraying to protect them from blight. Now, New Zealand didn't have blight until about 5 to 10 years ago. Australia and New Zealand had no blight. It had never been introduced. Well, it's there now because it's almost impossible to keep these things out with all the flying and trade going back and forth all over the place. So Some people, what they do is in the fall, they'll spread either plastic, they'll rake the ground, everything away, just bare ground. They'll put down plastic sheeting. And then as soon as, you know, those flowers will all fall during the season, as soon as the bushes stop flowering, they'll just roll that up. Now you could use paper, you could use a building paper, you could use paper bags. You just roll it all up, throw it in the trash, and get those out of your yard. At least you won't have that spores being formed and shooting in the air right under your bush, which because you know, right there. So that would be a disaster. And we talked a little bit about Phytophthora root rot. So there's not a lot you can do to protect yourself against flower blight except get rid of the old flowers. You can also put a thick layer of compost on the surface of the soil to try and cover up the apothecia. But like I said, there's camellias everywhere. They're very popular. They're extremely popular all through the 1950s and 1960s. They aren't as big a water hog as you think. You can water them a lot less than a fern or roses out in the full sun that have to be watered probably twice a week in the summer. So they're a moderate water use, more in line with the citrus. You should plant them on the east or north sides of your house. Well, they'll get morning sun and be protected from the sun in the afternoon. They will burn in the full sun in the afternoon. Maybe you can get away with that with red-flowered camellias in full sun along the coast. But in the hot inland valleys, if they get full sun in the afternoon, it'll fry them. So you got to keep them from being exposed to too much full sun. That's for your camellias. So let's just think about what we're going to be doing next week. Well, next week, I think we'll talk about insects. It's very important that you recognize the different kinds of insects, different groups of insects. Basically, I separate them into two large groups. That's very simplification of insects. Chewing insects and sucking insects. We'll talk about that more next week. Hopefully you'll go out and enjoy this wonderful afternoon we have today. It's perfect time to get out and start thinking about what you want to do with your garden in the next 2 months. We're warming up. Remember, the kind of a planting date for your vegetable garden, for a summer vegetable garden, is mid-March. You can get the tomatoes in a little early. Last year I planted my tomatoes in February, did really well that way. Most years I plant in February and they just sit there and I don't get early fruit. But I got really early fruit last year. I was actually picking fruit at the end of May, which is way early for me for my tomatoes. But we'll be back next week. We'll be talking about insects and we'll talk about how to control them. And then the week after that, we'll talk about integrated pest management. If you're a student, we're going to get the syllabus up this week. And you can email me and we'll talk about all the requirements for completing the course. I want to thank our crew next door for their hard work and getting the show on today. And I want to wish everyone happy gardening and enjoy our wonderful weather. And I'll see you next week. This has been Gardens of California, and happy gardening.